Can I start, Mr. Heston, by asking you who first offered you a contract at Paramount in what must have been, what, 1949?
Late 1949. I had been resisting the blandishments of the studios for a year or so, and every time I'd do a play on Broadway or a live television piece, why, quite routinely, the studios would approach you. It was sort of the expected thing, but what they were still offering then was an exclusive studio contract, which is important to your examination of the great days of the great studios, because the studio system, even by 49, had ended, but the studios didn't know it, and the whole system was still in place, and in fact everyone was under exclusive contract. All the writers, all the actors, all the directors, all the producers were under contract to one or another of the great studios. That, in fact, was what made it possible for the success, the very early success in their mid-20s, which all of us were, of the live TV generation. Because due to the fact that the studios refused to allow any of the people they employed to make films to work in live television at all, and because people of any reputation on the Broadway stage wouldn't do it because it didn't pay any money, that left this marvelous new medium to those of us who were largely unemployed. And among actors, it included me and Jack Lemmon and Joanne Woodward and James Dean and Walter Matthau and George C. Scott and, I don't know, four or five others. And it was a marvelous opportunity, probably the most shining opportunity that has been presented to actors and writers and directors since sound came to movies and movies were revolutionized. And the reason this happened, because I'm sure many of the actors and writers and directors under contract to the studios would have liked to experiment with live TV. It was a marvelously creative and stimulating medium at the time. but they weren't allowed to. And therefore, when I was offered a contract, it seemed to me unnecessarily restrictive and something I didn't want to do, so I turned down two or three of these. But Hal Wallis, who was always a remarkably astute observer as well as interpreter of film, recognized that it was changing, that it was over, in fact. And so he offered me a non-exclusive contract that limited the number of pictures he could, for which he could use my services, allowed me to make pictures for a certain number of pictures for anybody else that I wanted to, allowed me to return to the stage at my option and to do live television at my option, which was a revolutionary kind of contract and was all I required. He offered this not because he thought I was so remarkable a prospect, but because he recognized that this was the pattern of the future. I was very fortunate to come along wanting the kind of contract I did just when it was possible to get it. And Hal Wallis offered me the contract. He had by then moved from Warner's, whose reputation of the 30s and 40s he had created almost single-handedly, to Paramount.
When you first went to Paramount, and you know, your first day there, or the first time you went into the building, were you sort of surprised? What was your impression of Paramount? Was it smaller than what you thought it would be, bigger, or about? Can you remember your first day, as it were?
Yes, I can remember. I had never been to California before. I fought in the North Pacific in the Aleutians in the war, but we went overseas from Seattle, and I'd never been in California. And so when I flew out for the conferences with Wallis to decide what my first film would be, it was my first look at Hollywood, and the classic images remain in my mind. There are things that are as you expect them to be. The first time I saw London, since all four of my grandparents were either Scots or English, why, all my child's books had been all the English books, and indeed there were the red pillar boxes and the bobbies and the hedgerows and Trafalgar Square and all those things, and the Thames. And similarly, when I flew in to land in Hollywood, there really were searchlights coming up. There wasn't smog then, but Hollywood, and there were orange trees, and you could smell them, and palm trees, and you could see them against the night sky, just as it had been in all the posters. And when I went the next morning to Paramount, the great iron-grilled gate with Paramount Pictures in curly script above it was as I had seen it in photographs. So my first impression of Paramount seemed what I had expected it to be. And my time there deciding on my first picture, which didn't turn out to be very remarkable, was a rewarding one.
I wanted to ask you about that. Your first picture was, forgive my pronunciation, but I've always called him William Dieterle, is that right?
Dieterle.
Was he a good director, in fact, to teach you your craft?
I think, unfortunately, at that time I wasn't keeping my journal, so I can't be certain of my recollections at the time. Bill Dieterle certainly did some good films, and he was German, I think, had begun his career in the silent film in Germany. He had a curious idiosyncrasy. He always wore white cotton gloves, not very grand gloves, not kid gloves, just plain, like elevator operators wear, and bellboys. I never heard him say so, that he wore them because he had once infected a cut in his hand on the gears of a camera. That seems somehow unlikely, but that's the only explanation I ever heard. But he always wore it, and a rather dashing hat, and an ascot on the set. But he was very knowledgeable, communicated very well, though perhaps not in a very interior way with the actors. But I think he made of the film I did for him, which was called Dark City, the kind of picture they make now as a movie of the week. It was a thriller, and it was effectively done and did well enough. Again, movies that there's no such category now. No movie does well enough. The movie either disappears or is a hit, but it was different then. I can't remember that it seemed that hard to do, to make the transition from the stage to film. I think the reason for this is I had had by that time a considerable experience in live television, which was an ideal transition from the stage, because it was like the stage in that you rehearsed for couple of weeks, and you did it from beginning to end, like a play. But it was nevertheless a camera medium, and you had to understand about hitting marks and being aware of voice levels and things like that, and camera placements. So I didn't really find the switch to film a particularly taxing one. I drove past the Demille building, which was at the southwest corner of the lot, through a gate, a drive-in gate. And he was standing on the steps of the building talking to five or six of his staff. And so I waved to him as I drove out, having been introduced after all, we had met. And he waved back and nodded. And I was told later, after I'd driven off, why he said, who was that young man? And it is not true that his secretary took down every word he said, but his secretary took down a good deal of what was said and had the answers to questions like that readily on tap. And she flipped back through her book and she said, that's a young Broadway actor named Charlton Heston, Mr. DeMille. He just made a picture for Hal Wallis called Dark City. You ran it 10 days ago. You didn't like it. And he said, but I liked the way he waved. He said, we better have him come in and talk about the circus picture.
I got tied up with a cop who's riding with us, looking for someone.
Anything serious?
Murder.
He used to be a doctor.
You find the darndest people around a circus, don't you?
Yeah. What was this good news? I could use some.
Good news? Oh, Sebastian there. He's got feeling in that hand.
Uh-huh.
Yes, and if there's still feeling, complete recovery is very possible.
Is that a professional opinion?
That's a clown's opinion. Why don't you rile him up a little? might get your flyer back.
Yeah, I'll do that. By the way, they're going to take some fingerprints when we get in.
Okay.
So I often think what opportunities might have been denied me had I failed to wave to C.B. DeMille.
When you actually came, did you actually test for DeMille for the part?
No. I don't know whether he ever tested anybody. I never was aware of his testing anybody. He certainly didn't test me. I, of course, made two films for him. And he used instead another method. It's common enough to interview actors for a part, but both for the role of the circus manager in The Greatest Show on Earth and Moses in the Ten Commandments, the procedure by which I was finally chosen was the same. Mr. DeMille would call me in. My agent would say, Mr. DeMille would like you to drop by his office tomorrow. He wants to talk to you. And you would go in, and he had a fairly large private office, which seemed somewhat smaller than it was because it was always crowded with the impedimenta of pre-production or post-production, as well as the memorabilia of his extensive and impressive career. And he would get up and ask you to sit down, and then he would tell you the story of the picture he was planning from the point of view of your character. And he would say, this manager is faced with the problem of trying to keep the circus going under canvas at a time when increasing costs are making the dates in the big indoor arenas obligatory, which of course has happened. There are no circuses under canvas now. And he would say, and this happens, and then there's a train wreck, and as he told you the story and the relationship with the clown who was a fugitive from justice, and the circus aerialist and the vain, conceited foreign trapeze star who disrupted the smooth running show. Why, he would show you sketches and models of the sets and costume designs and all these things, which was fine with me. It was very interesting. He always told the stories quite electrifyingly. The only problem was I wasn't certain of the right response, because he never said, now this is the part I'm considering you for, and do you, what are your ideas about this? Do you feel you could play this? And if you do, why? I could, that's how acting interviews go. I could handle that easily. But he never asked you that. So it seemed all you could do is say, well, that certainly sounds like that's going to make a good picture, because I somehow sensed that it wasn't appropriate to say, well, I'd certainly like to play that part. Sounds like a great part. You just could say, well, that should make a marvelous movie. It really sounds great. And you would stay perhaps half an hour, 40 minutes. And then he would say, well, it's good of you to stop by. I really enjoyed talking to you. And say, well, I enjoyed it too, Mr. DeMille. Thank you very much. And say, I'll see you again. But obviously he used the procedure just to see how you handled yourself and how you looked and how you sounded as you moved about the office and picked things up and responded to jokes and stories. And he may have handled it other ways with other actors, but I don't think so, because I've heard other actors say the same thing.
How nervous were you on that first day of the Demille picture when you went on the Reddish story, Reddish show?
You mean when we began shooting?
Yeah.
Well, I wasn't nervous. I've probably would have been better off throughout my career if I had been a little more nervous always. But I don't recall ever having been excessively afflicted with what the layman calls stage fright, which of course isn't really stage fright at all. It's kind of an infusion of adrenaline. I do remember the first day of shooting vividly, and it was not a success from my point of view. This, as I said, was my second film, and my first enormously important film. It was obviously the most important picture made that year, and eventually won the Academy Award, and great expectations were rife on every hand. And we began shooting with the circus then in winter quarters at Sarasota, Florida, where we shot for 5 or 6 weeks. Then we went on the road with them for a couple of weeks. Then we came back to Paramount and did the interiors. But the first scene I was to do was to drive into the Big Top in a Jeep, drive up to the center ring where Jimmy Stewart, as the Buttons, the clown, was standing in rehearsal clothes, and he was to point out to me that Betty Hutton, as Holly the aerialist, was rehearsing a trapeze stunt I had forbidden her to do as circus manager. And I was to leap out of the Jeep and run to the center ring and order her down. It's really a simple enough shot. I had maybe no lines at all in that first shot. I had indeed to drive the Jeep to the mark and get out and run into the ring. And Jimmy Stewart had most of the dialogue. And I managed to drive the Jeep into place and listen appropriately to James Stewart. And I leapt out of the Jeep, ran to the center ring, and tripped over the ring curb and fell flat in my face. But Mr. DeMille was willing to accept that lapse, and I managed to do it right the second time.
Was he a slow worker as the shooting goes? I mean.
Well, I've worked for three directors who shot very long schedules. Demille, George Stevens, and William Wyler. They all worked these long schedules differently, but none of them wasted time. Nothing like the stories we hear of Cimino on Heaven's Gate or the debacles that, with Monroe and Elizabeth Taylor, where most of the time is spent not doing anything. Stevens would never do very many takes. I would say 4 or 5 was, if not an average, he seldom would do more than 5 or 6 maybe. But he did an enormous variety of setups, different setups. You would work all day in a scene and you say, well, that has been well and truly covered, that's that. And he'd finish the day's work and you'd say, what are we doing tomorrow? He said, we'd better come back here tomorrow. Just maybe 1 or 2 shots. And you'd come back the next day and you might likely spend all of that day too. And he would cover it really with a whole different approach in camera terms. Not so much in the scene, but in camera terms.
Who are you? I don't know you. Yet I know you.
Baptize me, John.
What is your name?
Jesus.
Where born?
Bethlehem.
Is it not you who should baptize me?
Why do you ask me this?
Scriptures, it's written, from you, Bethlehem, shall he come forth, who is to be ruler in all Israel, whose coming has been of old, from time everlasting.
Wyler, on the other hand, although I have come to believe it was exaggeration that he ever shot 40, 50 takes on anything, did, in the two pictures I worked for him on, one of them shooting for 4 months, the other for 9, a little more than 9, did do a great many takes, in the course of which, I would say his average was maybe 8 or 9. And in the course of that, he would often alter the scene itself a great deal, and the setup, not change the setup completely so that you had a choice of cuts, but he would keep, say, we need a little more dolly track here. Let's have I've got to get a little farther past him here. And he said, no, move the track over more. He said, this is the wrong lens. Let's use the 28 instead. I made a mistake. And of course he would be altering the performance all the time, relentlessly, and with a frightening degree of concentration, and a great deal of abrasion to it, really. He would keep sanding away at it, without much empathy for the actor's creative condition, but an infinite sense of taste in performance. The best taste in performance I've ever seen. Demille, on the other hand, although, again, when I knew him, he was at the end of his career, and an old man, really, but a man who, well, as we've said earlier, had learned to conserve his energies, still spent them with profligate abandon in pursuit of the scene. And he, you know, would have limousines and all kinds of creature comforts. But he would arrive, he always ran his dailies at the beginning of the day. Almost all directors that I've worked with run their dailies either at the end of the day or quite often at lunch, which is a good time to do it, really. I prefer that myself because you use what is otherwise slack time. But DeMille said, I want to look at my dailies when I'm fresh. And of course it makes sense, again, in terms of his concern with his own energy levels. So he would run first thing in the morning at 8 o'clock. And everyone was welcome in the company. Again, many directors are very selective in who can see them, or if they're willing to have the actors and the crew people see them, they want to see them first. Wyler always ran with his cutter, and he was willing to have me look at dailies, for example. But he didn't even mind if I saw them first, because he would often not see them, and then he would run 6-7 hours at a stretch, but on a Sunday. But he didn't want anyone with him when he looked at them, except the cutter. But DeMille would see them with most of the company that wanted to see them at 8 o'clock. Then he would come on the set, having rehearsed and laid out the first shot the night before, which made sense, because then that could be all prepared when he came on. But then he would examine it very closely, and he would call for the sketches and look at the sketches. He, like Hitchcock, had what amounted to frame designs for the major setups in almost every scene. And he would call for those and look at those, and he might have had a photograph taken the night before, which would have been developed overnight, and he would look at the transparencies and examine the props and the wardrobe, maybe makes it. And though everyone was unfailingly on time and ready at 8:30, including he himself, you very seldom actually turned a camera till 9:30 or even a quarter of 10. And it would usually be on the master setup for a scene. He didn't do a great many setup takes either, maybe 5 or 6 at most. Nor did he do a great many very extensive coverage. I think this came from his early training, you know. After all, when he began shooting films, Griffith had not invented the close-up yet, nor had he invented the boom. He always was fond of saying that Griffith invented the close-up and he invented the camera boom. The palette of shots available in his early days was a much smaller one. And so he would often use, the painter's analogy is a good one, a fairly restricted palette of coverage. And he worked in a rather deliberate and careful pace, and would think carefully through before he would do a shot. Then, after the shot, he would sit and think for maybe a minute before he decided whether to print or do another take. Whereas most directors say, that's good, okay, do one more, and they try to keep up a kind of a pace of performance. But DeMille didn't choose to do it that way, nor did Stevens, for example. They both were very deliberate men.
Confided in you about how he felt as an actor before the cameras on Sunset Boulevard? Did he ever was he ever proud of that, or did he as a general impression. Did he ever mention it to you?
No, but I knew him well enough to know that he enjoyed being the most famous director there was, the only director outside of Hitchcock, I think, whose name ever appeared on theater marquees. In theaters all over the world, it would say Cecil B. DeMille's The Ten Commandments, not Charlton Heston in The Ten Commandments, just as it would say Alfred Hitchcock's Psycho. And he was a very good speaker, very much as many directors are not. Many directors, as you must have noticed, are not even very good interviewers. I mean, they seem uncomfortable even talking into a microphone, and not at ease in a television situation, and often communicate rather poorly. But DeMille was an excellent speaker and was very much at ease doing it.
Can I go on to Universal now, Mr. Heston, and ask about Touch of Evil, which, as I say, seems like a picture which very unusual for Universal to produce in the late 50s when it was a soap opera studio. And how did they come to finance it, or how did it come about?
Well, that was made in in late 56. The script was submitted to me. I think, owed one or two pictures to Hal Wallis, but I was making pictures for other producers then and had begun to work on other lots than Paramount. And Universal submitted the script to me, and it was a routine, though effective enough, police story. But police stories, having been a staple of film almost from the beginning, depend, like westerns, rather more than other sorts of pictures, on the director. And I said as much to the Universal people. I was up in Michigan in the woods for Christmas, where I was raised at the time, but I talked on the phone to my agent, really, and I said, find out who's going to direct this. I said, it's really hard to tell. The script's okay, but you can't have a new story, really. It's just how well it's done. And so the word came back. They said, well, we don't know yet who's going to direct it. A director's not been set, but we've got Orson Welles to play the heavy. And I said, well, you know, Orson Welles is a pretty good director. I said, why don't you have him direct it? And their response was as though I had suggested that my mother direct the film. You know, it seemed an amazing proposition to them. But after due consideration, they came back and they said, well, okay. Now, Orson I don't think had directed a picture in Hollywood at that time since Macbeth, which was around 1946, something like that, at Republic. He had directed a few pictures like Othello in Europe and had acted in to finance his directing career and all a string of Fox pictures, Prince of Foxes and all those things. But he'd not directed in Hollywood since 46, and I'm sorry to say has not directed in Hollywood since. And he rewrote the entire script, which I knew he would, and I think directed it brilliantly. I think one of the reasons Universal was willing to have him direct it was A, they wanted me to do the picture, B, they recognized that my contention that he was capable of directing it was reasonable enough, and C, it was budgeted for less than $1 million, and they felt reasonably enough, how can we be hurt? Orson did, of course, remarkable things with the film. It's, in many ways, a remarkable film. He, at the same time, alienated Universal. There's a streak in Orson that requires this of him in some odd way, I think. It's commonly said, accurately enough, that Orson deserved better of the film industry than he got. I think it's also fair to say that the film industry deserved better of Orson than it got. We should have more Welles films, and if he had been willing to exercise his considerable charm in the direction of the men that pay for the films, he might have had a chance to make more. It's not that hard to do, especially if you're as intelligent and charming as Orson is. But somehow he could not bring himself to do it, and the producer, a man named Zug Smith, was in effect hardly more than an errand boy. Fair enough, but you've got to deal with the studio, and you've got to make them feel that you're glad they gave you the money for the picture, and that you are responsive to their concerns, which really consist only of breaking even, preferably making a profit, and he couldn't respond to this. But nevertheless, working for him was a remarkable experience. He taught me a great deal about acting. I had my first exposure to the cutting room while he was cutting that film. I spent some time sitting watching him cut. It was on that picture that I first began to understand the choice of lens, the use of the camera. Russ Meddy was at his apogee as one of the great cameraman and perhaps the fastest of the great cameramen. Very few great cameramen are fast. Russ was fast. And the logistics as well as the mechanics of filmmaking, the vocabulary of film, was something I really began to understand with Orson. And, for instance, although the technology for it barely existed then, I believe in Touch of Evil, we shot the first actual dialogue scene in a real moving car. And to load the camera on the front of the car and the batteries and the recording equipment, much bulkier then than it is now, even in 1957 than it is now, and put me and the other actor in the front seat of an open convertible, to drive it at speed down a narrow street meant that there couldn't be an operator on the hood of the car because I then couldn't see to drive. And there was no room for a sound engineer in the back. And so we operated it ourselves. And we were shown how to get the camera up to speed. And so we'd go down a mile and a half down the road. And I'd say, all right, turn over. And you'd turn on the switch. And I'd say, speed, he'd say, action. And then we'd come down to the end, and I'd say, cut. And Orson would say, how was it? I say, very good, we better do one more.
Thank you.
Yes, I met him and had any contact, extensive contact with him, only during Agony and the Ecstasy. Fox had three big pictures on location in Europe at the same time that summer, which was, what, 63? I think 63. And one was Sound of Music, one was Magnificent Men and Their Flying Machines, and the other was Agony and the Ecstasy. And Zanuck was, I guess, in his period of Achilles sulking in his tent in Europe at that period. It wasn't that he was still living in Europe then, and was not actively running the studio, but was, I have no idea what relationship he had, but in any event, he functioned on Agony as the closest thing to a producer we had. Doc Merman was the unit manager and was logistically the producer. He was highly capable of handling that effectively. Carol Reed directed, but there was no one listed as a producer. And Zanuck was by no means on the set on a day-to-day or even on a week-to-week basis. But he visited several times and I'm sure looked at footage. I remember when we began shooting, which was in the marble quarries above Florence, where Michelangelo actually did quarry marble. And he took great issue with what he took to be a turban I wore in that scene. And he said, "You look like a goddamn actor, for Christ's sakes." And it was, in fact, a headscarf of the kind worn by all marble workers, cutters in the quarries. And there exists a sketch of Michelangelo wearing exactly such a headscarf, but it struck him as a bit dashing, I guess. And I was not involved in the cutting of that film and have no idea to what extent he had input, but he did, I know, function as what producer we had. But I never knew him well and have no awareness of the intricacies of his stormy history at Fox, though I'm well aware of his reputation as you said, perhaps the most creative, the most genuinely a filmmaker of all the legendary studio heads.
one studio, if you like, try to hold on more than any others to the traditional roots of the majors, of the eight or nine majors, probably thinking of Ben Hur, which of course was financed by MGM with a lot of money. This was what, 1958, it was released 59. So, in other words, you know, they were putting a lot of money into pictures like that, and there were other big pictures like Minnelli's Four Horsemen and what have you, which were still being made with a lot of studio money, weren't they, really? I mean, it was funded by studio.
Mind you, pictures up until fairly recently, and to a certain extent even now, are financed by studios, but they are. They take projects submitted to them by independent producers or individual actors. But in the mid-50s, they were still making most of their pictures themselves and searching out the projects themselves. I believe it was still fairly rare. I suppose actors like Stewart and Cooper, Gable, I think, was still under contract to Metro in the mid-50s, so that wouldn't have been the case with him, but some of the major stars of the mid-50s were probably beginning to bring projects that they were interested in to the studios. But the way pictures were financed and planned was still more or less in place. But the whole structure of the contract system had changed. I don't think many directors, I think some directors and cameramen were still under contract. I remember as late as when I made Planet of the Apes and Agony in the Ecstasy at Fox, Leon Shamroy was still under contract. So the more senior of their cameramen, directors, and to a lesser degree probably actors, perhaps still had outstanding long-running contracts, but they had stopped signing new people.
Take your stinking paws off me, you damn dirty ape!
Glad that you started in the studio days looking back, or would you rather have been starting today like your Dustin Hoffman's, your Al Pacino?
Well, in the first place, my awareness of the studio system had little effect on my own career. It's historically interesting to me because I could see what had been. But as I said, the conditions under which I came in were the independent contract that still exists, and I was, I suppose, among the early actors to get a percentage of the net, and among that tiny happy band that gets a percentage of the gross. I think the advantage of starting when I did is that it seemed to work quicker then. Actors like me and Paul Newman and Steve McQueen, who are my contemporaries, mostly became fairly important and able to have some leverage on their careers by their late 20s. The next bunch, which I guess would include Dusty Hoffman and Redford, not till their early 30s. Did they become, I'm not speaking of years, but their ages. They were in their early 30s before it was really happening for them. And I think the next bunch, which would include, Nick Nolte and De Niro and Pacino, I think were in their mid-30s when it happened for them, which, to the extent that that's accurate, and I think it is, seems to indicate that it's harder to do. And obviously, the sooner it happens for you, the sooner, if as an independent filmmaker, you value the independence you have and the right to make your own choices, even though they are often the wrong choices, we all understand that, then the sooner you get to do that, the more turns at bat you get. That's what we like about it. Obviously, that it the early 50s was the soonest that could possibly happen, because that you couldn't function that way before then. So coming in when I did was probably a good thing.
God forgive me for seeking vengeance, but my path is set. Into your hands I commit my life. Do with me as you will. I'm not entirely positive for everybody that the independent filmmaker system is the best system anyway. It's all very well for me and, 10 or 12 actors and 3 or 4 actresses and 6 directors and 3 writers. But what about everybody else? The advantage to the studio system was everybody was there were each studio had a large body of actors, directors, writers, under contract, paid every week, not rewarded as generously as we are now with percentages and pieces of the gross and so on and so on, not with the right to have input on the script and the cutting and some control of the casting and even sometimes choice of directors. That's all very well. But you got a lot of chances to work.
you got a lot of chances to fail. Even when I began in the 50s, we made enough films so that it was okay that if several of them were kind of lousy. You had to have a success fairly early on. The fact that The Greatest Show won the Academy Award as my second film was important to me, because then you get some chances. But you could have make lousy pictures. Now it's very dangerous to make a lousy picture. particularly, even more dangerous to make an unsuccessful picture. A lot of successful pictures are lousy. If they're successful, they don't mind. But they better not be unsuccessful.